morning and welcome to worship at Second Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're here this morning. It's a gray and dreary day as we begin the first Sunday of Advent, but we pray that this service will add some sparkles to the beginning. We're glad you're watching with us somewhere, and welcome. Let's stand for our call to worship. God spoke through the prophet Isaiah.
Comfort, O comfort my people.
A voice cries out,
prepare the way of the Lord.
Every valley will be lifted up, every mountain brought low.
And the glory of the Lord will be revealed.
All people shall witness this together.
For the mouth of God has spoken.
Come, O come Emmanuel.
We wait for you to enter our world and our lives in a new way. Let us worship with hope this day.
cannot save ourselves, though we may be frantic with activity. Our efforts to do so do not yield peace, the peace that you can give. Today we would be quiet enough to hear your voice. Today we would be still enough to feel your touch. Help us to find that place where we can receive you as well. Wait as our hearts act and listen as you speak. Our whole world needs your peace. Let us come before you and learn from your ways, laying down our weapons and feeding the hungry. Come to us now, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Central to our Christian faith is confession, and we come now to a time of confession. Even when we have been too busy to notice, God has been constantly loving us and encouraging us to grow in the line of God's love. We can trust God with our deepest confession. Let us pray together. We confess, O God, that we do not take seriously your coming into our world. We do believe that salvation is near. We do not act outrightly, loving you as our neighbors and ourselves, nor do we amend our swords and spears.
Forgive us, we pray, that we might once again walk in your light, choosing for the world our hearts. Amen.
Let us be silent for a moment. Hear these words of assurance. Our scripture tells us that we are made in the image of God, that our bodies are the temple of God. God loves us through and through, all in body, mind, and soul. Praise God for the breath of new life and the Spirit who is willing to fill our changed hearts. Amen. We come now on this first Sunday in Advent to light our Advent wreath. You know that the Advent wreath is one of the oldest traditions in the Christian church. The circle symbolizes the unending nature of God. He has no beginning, he has no ending. The evergreens symbolize the everlasting nature of God. And the light symbolizes the light of the world, Jesus coming into our world. We light this Advent wreath now. Join me responsibly. Advent is a time of wonder, the wonder under the promised one. On this first Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of hope and wonder.
How may we hold on to hope so many live in poverty and despair?
We light this candle of hope and we wonder.
God is our hope.
We light this candle for hope.
And we know the wonder of our promised one who gives us the gift of hope, even when all seems hopeless.
Tremble before you, That's when the fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil. Come down and make your name known to your enemies, and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no one has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continue against him, you are angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like the one who is unclean, and all of our righteousness acts are like filthy rags. We shall shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sin. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay from your potter. We are the work of your hands. Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. We turn now to the psalm, and it's Psalm 80, verse 1 through 7, and 17 through 19. Hear God's word. Hear us, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, who sits enthroned between the cherubim, shines forth between Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Awaken your mind, come and save us. Restore us, O God. Make your face to shine upon us that we may be saved. O Lord God Almighty, how long will your anger smolder against the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of your tears. You have made them drink from the bowl full. You have made us a source of contention to our neighbors, and our enemies mock us. Restore us, O God Almighty. Make your face to shine upon us, that we may be saved. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man, you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord God Almighty. Make your face to shine upon us, that we may be saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We share now together hymn number 8, Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates. Coming, when the world comes in, when Jesus comes the second time, and causes us to know about Jesus coming the first time. Jesus being very harsh, he's preaching a turn or burn, or come to God sermon. It's an evangelistic sermon that is trying to scare people. And then he acts redemptively in the end. So Mark 13, chapters, verses 24 through 37, let us stand as we sing. But in those days following that distress, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall upon the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, men will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And he will send his angels to gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as twigs gather, get tender, and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that it is near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all of these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will last forever. And no one knows about that day or that hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son of the Father. But be on guard, be alert. You do not know when that time will come. It's like a man going to war. He leaves his home and puts his servants in charge, each with the assigned task, and tells them, one at the door, to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Thank you, Baxley and Sabbath. That was beautiful. That helps us to usher in Advent this season. You know, as I mentioned, it's dreary and rainy and supposed to get worse and kind of cool. How hard would it have been for you to come to church if we had not had the COVID experience today? It's cold, it's raining. We're coming off a holiday season, Thanksgiving weekend. It's tough to get up and get to worship on the first Sunday of Advent. One of my favorite stories is about a man who found himself in a similar situation. He was sleeping peacefully on a cold, rainy Sunday morning, and his wife comes in to get him up for church, and he just pulls the covers over his head and tightly. So it said, with some measure of resolve, I do not want to go to church today. She poked and prodded him, but he just held on to the covers more tightly. And again saying, I do not want to go to church today. His wife, a devout church member, asked him through the covers why he didn't want to go to church. He said, well, it's cold outside and it's warm in here. Anyway, I don't like church. The sermons aren't that good. The music is ho-hum. The people are mean, and no one likes me down there. I am not going. His wife answers back sharply, honey, you have to go to church. You are a preacher. Thank you. Sometimes it's hard to get to church. And with COVID now, many people cannot get to church. There are so many things that we could be doing, but we have to know that church is important. The model I was taught in seminary, if it was not outright taught, it was implied that if you're a successful preacher, you can fill the sanctuary. Numbers equal success. Thankfully, many pastors in my generation measure success by intentionality and purpose. So how success is determined. And so it is with intentionality and purpose that we find ourselves in this beautiful sanctuary on the first Sunday of Advent, patiently moving through the days before Christmas, waiting, hoping that something special, something genuine, something spiritual happens to us in this Advent. Praying that Christmas will not come and go this year, leaving us spent and hollow and cold as it happens this year. I am almost sure that Benjamin Franklin, who was immortalized the words, patience is a virtue. And it happens to be true, to be patient, even in the most impatient situations, elevates one to a virtuous status. And I'm not sure who the verbalist was who uttered, good things come to those who wait, but this is equally true. Waiting is important. Patience is virtuous. And good things generally happen to those of us who wait. The late Irma Brombeck wrote in one of her many humorous columns that there's a certain level of impatience that comes upon men of a certain age. And I happen to think this is true. I think in her column, it was about her husband, she contended that men in middle age contract adult onset impatience. Or even smallest situations where we have to wait for something, for anything, interrupts a major situation and it upsets us. And I think this is where I find myself these days. I'm not as patient as I used to be. And I have adult onset impatience. You know, I went to a high school game, football game with my sister, Lynn, a couple of years ago. It was a rather big game. She was there to see her daughter cheer, and I was too. And we stood in line for about 20 minutes to buy tickets, and it was one of the biggest games ever in Oklahoma history. This is a gone Daphne. It was a playoff game. And after standing in line, my sister and I were about two persons away from buying our tickets. But these four guys casually merged into the front of the line, breaking in line, moving right in behind us. These guys were big, And the good people behind us were annoyed, but they were not going to say anything. Well, my adult onset impatience of fuel, along with my long-standing sense of justice, it just is not right that someone could break in line and put themselves before hundreds of people. And I said something like, well, you would have thought I insulted their mother. I said, you can't do this. You can't break in line. And one of them said to me, well, what are you going to do about it? I turned to my sister Lynn and said, what are we going to do about it? And my sister is about 5'3 and sometimes feisty. I tell you what we're going to do about it, she said. She turned to the mass of people behind them in line, and she started yelling, these guys are trying to break in front of you. They think they can get away with it. That's not right. And what are we going to do about it? It felt like a union rally. The crowd began to yell, no, 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 and literally shamed the boys to the back of the line. My sister looked at one of the boys and said, that's what we're going to do about it. Some people are willing to wait. Some people are impatient with the process of getting somewhere. And often we miss the message and the meaning that is found in waiting. There's always something there for us when we wait. And there is purpose in waiting if we're patient in the process. This is where we find ourselves today as we move through the long line of reaching Christmas. These days called Advent have much to say to us if we will be patient and we'll learn from the waiting. In our gospel lesson today, an odd one, as always, for the beginning of Advent, Jesus is pounding the pulpit about the end of the age. And I imagine he is frightening this congregation, those who are listening, with talk of the moon turning blood red, the sun being dark and falling stars and planets shaking. He says, the Son of Man will come in the clouds and will send his angels to gather the elect from all the four corners of the earth. Who are the elect? Am I one of them? Are you? It's scary if we don't understand. And we especially like here how the bad guys get what they deserve and the blessed get what they deserve. Now, I don't take this chapter in Mark as literally about the true second coming of Jesus. The first verse in chapter 13 of Leeds refers to the coming destruction of Jerusalem, which happened about 60 years after this was preached. I think Jesus is urging strong imagery to get our attention and to convey his urgent message that time is short and time is uncertain for all of us. What we miss in this colorful message is Jesus telling us that life can be brief and life can be fleeting. All things come to an end, and sometimes unexpectedly, but what will last and what will not pass away are the words and the message of the Son of God. His message is fiery. His sermon is that we are to watch, and I take this to mean being alert in every moment of life. And his message is to wait, and to find meaning in the waiting. I take that to mean no one should be in a hurry to get to our supposed destination if we miss the message along the journey. You know, there's some purpose to everything that happens. In every moment that we live, there are many miserable people in our world who are always anticipating what needs to happen. In that in anticipation of what they want to happen, they miss living today. This is a good message for the first Sunday of Advent. Live today. Anticipate tomorrow. Appreciate what is happening right now and what that means. Be alert to what God is saying to us today and embrace hope for the future. How easy is it to miss all the mysteries in the meaning of Christmas? To overlook the coming of the Son of God in our busyness, and overlooking the Son of God who's come into the world to save us. Advent says, slow down, look around you, listen, experience. experience. Touch, feel, embrace the day, and allow God to speak to you in these days. What we have is now. We're not promised tomorrow. We're not promised to make it to Christmas. We should be aware of today. You know, it's been years since I picked up a hitchhiker, especially at dusk. I used to do that all the time when I was younger. I suppose with age I'm a bit more conservative, and maybe a little more afraid. There have been times when I had reason to be afraid. But I did pick up a hitchhiker a few years ago on my way home from an Auburn football game. It was very late. The game didn't start until 7:30. And I was coming home on 280, and I was getting sleepy, so when you see somebody that's willing to ride with you, even though they have their thumb out, I tend to want them to help me stay awake. It was not that dark, and I almost missed seeing that thumb of a man who was about my age, but walking with great intensity. I stopped and backed up and blinked my lights to make sure he was not wearing a mask, and I could see him and see that he looked safe. The hitchhiker got in, stinking of jam, proceeded to tell me his story. I love people's stories. He had been in a fight with his brother who put him out of the car somewhere near Childersburg or Harpersville. He wasn't sure. He was from Illinois. He could not go back until he had $10,000. His mother lived in Greystone, and that's where he wanted to go. Even though he was drunk enough to be honest, and he told me about what the good things that were going to happen to him one day. As soon as he got straightened out and got the $10,000, that was going to fix everything. I found myself witnessing to him about the love and mercy of God, and that every life has purpose and every day has meaning, and that God did not want him to live for someday, but wanted him to live for this day, for this moment. I may have been talking more to me than to him, but he listened to some degree. So I got to the gates of Greystone. He got out, thanked me. In a fashion that only happy drunks can do, he opened his wallet. If this had a fairy tale or a Hallmark movie ending, he would have given me $10,000. But he opened his wallet and gave me a dollar. And I thought about it as I drove from the rest of the way home how much his situation is like the human situation at Christmas. And how much this situation mirrors our reason for Christmas. He was a person walking in great darkness, looking for something, and it is for him, and it is for you and me, the light that is coming to the world. And all the darkness around Chelsea at 1:30 in the morning cannot overtake the light that has come in the person of Jesus. This message is worth being patient. This message is worth waiting and watching these days we call Advent. And this message is that in the waiting we might see the people around us, the situations around us, and it gives us meaning to be a part of their lives. Listen, there's something special that God wants you to hear and experience this season. Maybe even a miracle. No one knows what's going on with COVID. All of us are tired of waiting for a cure or waiting for things to get better. But God can speak to us even in the COVID experience. Even the negative things that have happened to us, if we slow down and give it meaning, and be patient and wait, God will speak to us. So the message of this Advent season is, slow down, wait, and be patient. Hope is on the way. Let us share a moment of prayer. Good and gracious God, we thank you that you've come into our world in such a profound way. You teach us to hold on and to watch. You help us to be diligent in watching the things around us, where your word can make a difference, your presence can make a difference. This is our Advent prayer, that you would speak to us this season, that you would help us to be keen to what is going on around us, and to be diligent in sharing your love with the world. Our prayer is offered in the name of Christ. Amen. We sing hymn number 20, Watchman, Tell Us of the Night, and let us stand as we sing. TJ, tell us, you told us that you haven't seen your grandmother in how long?
Since February.
Since February. And she's in a nursing home, and does she understand what's going on?
Oh, yes. We FaceTime and talk. They were doing porch visits, but their numbers keep going up, so they have stopped that.
That's hard on the elderly person. Other prayer requests?
My mother-in-law, who is suffering from dementia, and then my daughter, who went through a recent surgery for appendectomy.
How is she doing?
She's doing much better. My daughter.
How about your mother-in-law?
She's having a very difficult time, as you can imagine.
So, what is her name?
Her name is Lala, and my daughter is Olivia.
Olivia, Lala, and Olivia, we pray. And what's your grandmother's first name, my daughter?
Letha.
And I have a good friend named Ethan. Of prayer requests. These are difficult times, and let us encourage one another with good news and with love and hope. Let us pray together. Our good and gracious God, it's a difficult time for many of suffered, who are suffering. The many people, the hands and the minds that take care of our sick and are exhausted, we lift them up to you. For our loved ones who are in a situation where they are sick, we pray for Letha that you would encourage her and help her to know what's going on and experience her family. We pray for Lala. We hope you would clear her mind and give her a sense of hope this Advent season that all is not lost. And Lord, we thank you that Olivia is recuperating, that you stood by her very closely. And Lord, we pray for ourselves. To teach us to be kind and loving, to help us to search to understand what we don't understand, and that we love you with heart and soul and mind, that we love our neighbors. We offer our prayer in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you're watching us on video, know that we are continuing during Advent video of our worship services, but if you want to drop in, keep a mask on, you can be here for that service. No hugging, no kissing. We're not even eating together. Announcements. This beautiful Advent wreath was given to the glory of God in memory of William Liddell Alverson, 1908 to 1991. He was a member of this church. Some of you remember him, but he is the father of Marilyn Alverson Gross, Marilyn Gross, and Jan Alverson Gross, McElroy. Jan is Marilyn's sister, and she passed away several months ago. So this is especially meaningful time as we light this candle of hope for them. Let us stand for our benediction. I charge you, whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Amen.